On today's show, our experts' reaction to revelations about Prince William and Prince Harry from a controversial new royal book, why this week was a big turning point for Catherine, and we discuss that row over the King's birthday phone call. It's been yet another fascinating week for the royal family. Hello and welcome to Palace Confidential. I'm Jo Elvin, and if you missed us last week, you won't have seen our new studio, which is fit for a king or a queen or indeed a prince or princess. And we'll be discussing all of those in just a moment. Here to help me do that this week is the Daily Mail's star columnist, Sarah Vine, Charlotte Griffiths, the editor-at-large of the Mail on Sunday, and in between them, of course, the Daily Mail's diary editor, Richard Eden. Welcome all. Now, a reminder that if you enjoy our show, please like and subscribe to our free channel to be reminded whenever a new episode arrives. I'm coming straight to you, Richard, to talk about Catherine, Princess of Wales. She held a major event this week. What can you tell us?
Wednesday was a big day for the Princess of Wales. She held a symposium as part of her Shaping Us campaign, which, as we know, is part of her early years, concentration on the early years and how important they are in the development, not just of a child, but how it can shape your whole life, really. So she got together experts, scientists, academics, and some really important figures, such as the former Prime Minister Tony Blair and the former Foreign Secretary William Hague, for a symposium at the Design Museum in London. She gave a speech, and it just showed how serious she was about this issue, and it followed. I think it sort of followed last week's Earthshot event by Prince William in Singapore, and this was kind of her chance to shine a light on the cause that matters most to her.
Yes, and it is getting serious, isn't it? She also managed, Sarah, didn't she, to bring two old political rivals together. You know a thing or two about how difficult that can be.
Yes, it's actually been quite an interesting week for bringing old political rivals together, not just in the royal circles, but also in mainstream politics. Yeah, I mean, I think she's got she's sort of found her stride. She's found a cause that is not controversial on any level, which is really important for a royal. Mm. You don't want anything that's going to really rock the boat. Who can, you know, what's not to like about her championing early years, which, you know, it's really important and actually doesn't really get that much focus.
And I think it probably, without sounding rude, there probably was a time where it sounded like a very soft, sweet little issue, but now it's getting more currency, isn't it? She's being taken more seriously.
And it is. I mean, I actually had a friend who's now sadly dead, who was in the Lords, who spent many years trying to push the issue of early years, because it is so important, particularly for children from difficult backgrounds, challenging backgrounds. You know, it really makes all the difference if you can just get them in the first couple of years, because so much damage is done in those early years. So I think it's a really, and again, politically, it's a cross-party issue. It's not something that is tribal in any way. No one is going to, again, you say she's been uniting politicians. That's really good.
Mm. Now, we like light and shade on this show, so I do want to have a little word about Catherine's outfit with its single bright colour.
Isn't that called colour blocking?
Colour blocking.
In fashion. You're in fashion.
Yes, you're absolutely right.
We were talking about socks, though. Can we just talk about your socks?
Yeah, we'll have a sock off in a minute, you and me, Richard. But it did feel a more modern version of what the Queen used to wear.
Yeah, exactly. So it's that classic tactic that the Queen had, which is that she knew she was quite a small person in a sea of people. So the best way to get noticed was to just wear the same colour from top to toe, and then you were either a sort of orange person or a purple person or a green person, and everyone could
like
see
you. Like a lovely royal human highlighter.
Yes, exactly. So she was very visible, and so Catherine's done that. It was purple.
It was the Quality Street purple.
Yeah.
That's what I'd call it. Yeah.
The Queen used to wear UV green, so I'm glad she didn't.
She did,
for that
one.
Well, there's still time. Now, Charlotte, let's talk about Remembrance Sunday for a moment. Always a sombre affair, but from the poignancy emerged what a lot of people really loved, some images of Catherine and Camilla, obviously maybe closer than people realise.
Yeah, I think there was a real warmth between the two of them, and I didn't actually notice it was missing until I now am seeing it more and more as the weeks go by. I didn't really notice before that they didn't give each other those looks or those friendly hand gestures so much as they do now. And I think it's probably because, well, they're united by a common enemy, to say the least. And they're both going to be queen one day because Camilla will be Dowager Queen and she will be she'll be Queen Consort, in fact. So, you know, they'll be united by that, and they're in a business relationship, and they're going to have more and more balcony appearances like that. So they may as well get on and become close.
But is it just me who hates the word dowager?
I know, it does sound so old-fashioned.
Really dowdy about it,
yeah,
isn't it?
Dowager Duchess.
Yeah.
I always think it was a really grand person.
Let's
rebrand.
With a
monocle. Do you think you have to have a monocle to be a dowager? I think you might do.
Possibly. We need to consult the etiquette book
of
rules on
that
one.
I also think with Catherine, I think that... I think Camilla's very... She's a little bit shaky. I think she's very tired after this tour. So maybe there's just a little bit of her sense. She's quite maternal, Catherine, isn't she? She's quite a kind person.
And she has a lot of respect for Camilla. Yeah. And... you know, Kate's really close with her own mother, so she's probably never been incredibly close with Camilla, but maybe as the years go by, Kate can be a sort of support for Camilla as she gets older and works really hard.
Well, we will have some more pictures of Camilla and Catherine's friendship later on in the show, so stick around for that. Richard, coming to you, both Camilla and Catherine were, of course, at the King's birthday dinner this week. But I know that one of your favourite subjects is the notable exceptions, and some people weren't there.
Well, of course, there was no Prince Harry, no Meghan. They confirmed...
Or Andrew.
Yes, I mean, Harry, their spokesman, confirmed that there was no contact, that they weren't invited. There was no Prince Andrew as well. But we had lots of... There were reports that it was going to be just a sort of dinner for friends. But actually, there were a lot of family there in the end. And some quite relatively distant members of the family, such as King Charles's... first cousin once removed, the Duke of Gloucester, Princess Margaret's son and daughter, Lady Sarah Chatto and the Earl of Snowdon. You know, so family members like that. So it was actually a big event, and lots of family there. But I think that Princess Anne and you know, Sophie, Edward, I think were on engagements elsewhere in the country. With Prince Andrew, it's intriguing. We just don't know if he was invited or not, but...
Well, he's very busy.
But credit to him, unlike Harry, he hasn't put out a statement, you know, making clear the position.
But I mean, I think this dinner, this party was very much him choosing the people that he wanted to see on his 75th birthday. I think he was just, you know, they really were. I mean, you say there were some quite distant relatives, but those are the people he likes. So he just had all the people he likes.
But how cheery can a birthday celebration really be if the notable exceptions, the notable absences are your immediate family?
Yeah, but I think if Harry has annoyed him to the level, to the degree that he has, he wouldn't. You know, he'd want to. He's not going to enjoy himself if Harry's there, because there's so much baggage now with Harry. So I think he just thought, I'm 75, I'm going to have a party and I'm going to invite my friends and that's that.
Well,
that's fair enough.
The main one was there, though, apparently Charlotte, Lady Susan Hussey, who everyone will be pleased to hear.
Yeah, she's someone who was momentarily pushed out into the cold and was let back into the fold, unlike Andrew and Harry. She was there and it was almost... I just feel like she has been invited to a lot of things, like the coronation, and I feel like they're almost making amends for that time that they had to make a real sort of show of sort of punishing her for her comments, and she has left the royal household, but she's still a friend, she's still William's godmother, and I think it was really nice that she was invited, and you know, she should have been really, because she's done decades and decades of loyal service for that family.
Well, I think one of the crucial points is, would all those guests have wanted to attend if they knew Harry and Meghan were going to be there? Would Prince William and Catherine have wanted to go? I'm not so sure.
I mean, it would have been a very different event.
I would have wanted to see exactly how that played out.
Yeah. But it would have been a very different event. I mean, there were a lot of people that he's known for a very long time, like the Palmer Tomkinsons. You know, he goes skiing with them still. You know, they're very close. They're good old friends that he had there. And I think that's what you do on your 75th birthday, if you're king.
Yeah, if we get there, let's see. Now, before we move on, I just wanted to tell you about something else coming up that I think you'll be really interested in. Fans of The Crown on Netflix will be excited to listen to The Mail's new podcast. It's called The Crown, Fact or Fiction. You join The Mail on Sunday's royal correspondent Natasha Livingston and royal biographer and Mail columnist Robert Hardman for a watch-along of The Crown's final season and find out which scenes are fact and which are fiction. Fascinating stuff. There will be a podcast to accompany every episode of the brand new sixth season of The Crown, And some episodes will feature some very special guests. So search for The Crown, Fact or Fiction, wherever you get your podcasts, and there'll be a link in the description below. So much more to come today, including a controversial new royal book, another one, and questions over a certain birthday phone call. But first, let's turn to an event that took place on Armistice Day, where the King unveiled two statues of his parents. The late Queen Elizabeth and Prince Philip have been immortalised with a pair of particularly poignant statues at the south entrance of the Royal Albert Hall. A young British sculptor, Poppy Field, great name, was chosen to create the works, and she told us about the experience.
Approaching commission of this magnitude was entirely different to anything I'd done before. Normally, I will do a commission portrait or a figure with a model in my studio. And in both cases, you have many hours with that person. And as the hours slip by, you get to know them, you get a sense of their character, and you can watch their body move or their facial features change as they speak. And you can collect these moments. And if you know things are going well, you'll create a sense of them, of their presence or essence or spirit. With this commission, I didn't have the physical presence of the Queen or Prince Philip, and even if I had had access to them, it wouldn't have been for long enough to create 2 meter monuments. So I had to put my background in the history of art to good use and research what were the most meaningful symbols and how could I technically convey them. They perhaps have one of the greatest marriages and partnerships of our time, and that maybe I could sculpt a love story as much as I could sculpt a representation of our Queen and Prince Philip. So I thought quite an exciting and contemporary way to represent them would be in civilian dress. And the highest form of civilian dress is white tie for a gentleman and evening dress for a woman. So I went to Gieves & Hawkes, the Royal Warrant Holding suit company, and they lent me white tie and fitted it to my model Jack, who posed for Philip. Similarly, with my model Meghan, we went to Cornelia James, the glove makers, and Cornelia had made gloves for the Queen throughout her own life. And I thought a fitting way of representing their shared lifetime of service would be to create one composition across the entire south porch facade. And in thinking of this one composition, it occurred to me that Prince Philip, a man as modern as tomorrow, was also the Queen's strength in stay. And he was known for following a couple of steps behind her. And the Queen, who gave us this amazing sense of stability during times of enormous social change, was there for us, the public. And so being able to convey Prince Philip looking over to the Queen meant that viewers in the West, who typically read from left to right, would follow his gaze. They'll follow him looking over to the Queen, who looks out to the public, which would engage the viewer. And because she's turning into the hall, the viewer should then feel encouraged to go into the building too. And that was important because the Royal Albert Hall has been known as the nation's village hall. So it was a love story, but also with the romantic appeal that involves the nation. It was very moving that the sculptures were unveiled by their son, King Charles, and also his wife, Queen Camilla, on Armistice Day. It was a day of remembrance. And I'm really proud that they got to see them, and also that they will have opportunities in the future to see them in the daytime and hopefully from a distance.
The brilliant Poppy Field there. You can see an extended interview with her on our channel where she reveals more about those works on Monday. So do check back in for that. Now let's hear some of your comments. Maggie Davies had this to say about our discussion about British designer Nikki Haslam daring to criticise the Wales family. She says, Nikki Haslam is old-fashioned. As someone who is also old, age-wise at least, I think the Prince and Princess of Wales' zest for life is very endearing. It humanises the royal family. Meanwhile, Barbara Gibbs is also Team Wales, as most of you were. She writes, I think seeing the Wales kicking balls, getting hands dirty and blending with commoners attracts far more young people than dressing in a snooty, high society manner. The Australian in me is going to leave that well alone. Meanwhile, Bea Reeves had this to say about the Sussexes not receiving an invitation to the King's birthday dinner. She says Harry and Meghan are angry because they didn't get the chance to snub the King. Had they been invited, they would not have attended. Playing poor us is getting very old. Well, that seems like a good time to go back to my panel. Richard, Harry might not have been invited to his father's birthday, but we were told that they did speak on the phone.
Oh my goodness. So The BBC credited sources, I think sources close to Harry, perhaps they said, but anyway, sources.
Does that mean it was Harry? I mean, can we? Is the elephant in the room?
Well, I tell you, it's the BBC, and they, you know what they're like. They only run things if they come from a very good source. And they reported that Prince Harry was going to telephone his father that day. So it had to be a source who had intimate knowledge of Prince Harry's mind and his intentions. Anyway.
I'm not sure that would be Prince Harry. Let's be honest.
Anyway, within hours, we learned that the telephone call did happen. There was an extended account of this telephone call.
Now, was it audio? Was it FaceTime? Was it Zoom? Give me the facts.
Well, we've got all the details that I can share. Now, it wasn't to me because, you know, I've been pushing at the palace. Tell me more. They wouldn't say anything. No, in the past, they're terrified of saying anything when it comes to Harry and Meghan. But the Telegraph, Daily Telegraph, which does enjoy... You know, it's one of those few newspapers that Prince Harry is not very rude about.
Yeah.
Well, anyway, they got the full account. So sources from somewhere told them that Harry had spoken to his dad. It was brilliant conversation, went so well.
Good afternoon, Father. They're going to
speak again next week. And it wasn't just him. The King also spoke to Meghan. You know, that's important to know. And Meghan had very thoughtfully prepared a video of their children, Prince Archie and Princess Lilibet, singing happy birthday to the grandpa they've rarely seen.
So, not the actual children, so a video of the children.
A video of the children.
Didn't speak to the actual children?
No, I think the video was already recorded.
Okay.
That's curious. It's interesting, isn't it? That is a lot of detail. Coming from Camp Montecito, sources of... If the palace had released those details, how do you think the Sussexes would have responded?
Oh, I mean, just imagine if it was, you know, on the other foot. I mean, they would have said it was intrusion into privacy. Look, we're talking about two privacy campaigners here, you know, but when it comes to other people's privacy, when it comes to phone calls, we get the details. Who knows from where? I'm not casting aspersions here.
No.
But anyway, it certainly wasn't to me. And to me, it does smack of desperation. It smacks of Harry and Meghan wanting to come back into the royal fold. They want to keep that link to the royals. I mean, look, we don't see Meghan sending videos of her children singing happy birthday to her father anymore. You know, he's been cut out. Who cares about him? But when it comes to the King and that connection, which, as we know, is very lucrative when it comes to Netflix deals, this sort of thing, they seem very keen to maintain that, and it does seem desperate.
It's extraordinary. And Sarah, in an interview with People magazine this week to promote his new book, Endgame, the author, journalist Omid Scobie, claims there is, quote-unquote, still a warmth with Harry and Charles, but that Harry is the one usually reaching out. I think opinions may vary on how warm that relationship is.
I think this is Omid Scobie desperately trying to milk the last drops of a cash out of his relationship. And what a strange name for a book, Endgame. Sounds like a sort of Hollywood blockbuster starring, you know, someone very macho.
It really does.
Well, it's very
odd.
For who?
I know,
yeah, it's not over yet.
It's very strange. I mean, you know, Omid Scobie has made a career, really, of sort of fueling this kind of feud between... I mean, they are making a lot of money off the pain of a family, you know, of this sort of slight tragedy between this very damaged boy, Harry, son, whatever, and Charles, who I understand is really suffering because of this thing. And he's very upset about the whole thing and the way it's gone, and he feels it very deeply. And I think, you know, he's 75, you know. I mean, I don't know. I always think with families, you know, if you don't want your relative to suffer if you love them, do you? So and it just seems that everything that Harry does is designed to hurt Charles in some sort of a way.
Where is he getting this stuff, Charlotte? Sticking with Omid's book, there's an interesting line where he reports that William calls Harry a defector. And, I mean, that's quite a strong term, and says that one of them had to move on to protect the crown.
I know, the line about moving on to protect the crown is, it explains in Omid's book, is Harry's opinions were too dangerous for the royal family. They had to get rid of him because he's so important and so dangerous. I mean, Harry's opinions aren't that well valued, to be honest. I mean, they veer off all over the place in different directions. So
they get a lot of airtime. I don't know if that's fair to say that they're not valued.
But I think there's an intimation that Harry was this loose cannon, this dangerous threat to the monarchy. I mean, the monarchy has lasted 1,000 years without Harry having some negative opinions.
But now it's Endgame. It's
all very Hollywood blockbuster, yeah. as you say. It's like, he's not this great defector. He's a sort of wayward individual that has caused a lot of trouble and is an irritant, possibly. But Harry can't use a word like irritant because, you know, he thinks of himself as too important for that. So in that way, I do feel like there's a sort of Omid link there, because Omid has also made them seem like this very grandiose couple who were a threat to the monarchy.
Well, there's this bit, Richard, that I must admit made me feel rather uncomfortable. In another part of the extract, there's a long description of Harry's side of the story about the day Queen Elizabeth died. What can you tell the viewers about this?
I mean, I must say it's frankly really rather tasteless, because it's all about, the gist of it is, oh, poor Harry was kept, and they all knew Queen Elizabeth was dying, but sort of failed to tell Harry and keep him informed. But just look at the facts. I mean, this is the Queen who was meeting the outgoing Prime Minister, Boris Johnson, greeting the new one, Liz Truss, that week. She had a party. I think there was a party planned the day of her death. You know, that, for example, King Charles, he wasn't there at Balmoral. He was at Dumfries House in Ayrshire at the time, and then raced to get there. So, you know, they were reacting to that sudden deterioration in her health. But, you know, according to Omid Scobie, oh no, they should have been, you know, keeping her informed. He particularly highlights, I think it was Prince William sort of wasn't returning his calls, that they were planning to travel up. But I think, frankly, that's just a consequence of how bad their relations were.
But I think the idea that on the day that the late Queen was dying, the most important thing in anyone's mind should have been Harry, is just absurd. And it's just obviously comes from Harry, because only Harry would think that.
Yeah.
You know, Harry thinks, like, things are more contrived than they actually are.
Exactly.
They were pretty busy as hell.
They were busy, they were worried, they were desperate, they didn't know what to do. You know, I remember that day very clearly. Yeah. We all heard rumours. It was a terrible situation. And it's like, Harry's going, yeah, but what about me? Yeah. I mean, he just is so spoiled in that respect, and the idea that he would sense that he would, Scobie would try to make it about him, make the drama all about Harry, when actually the thing was about the Queen dying. It had nothing to do with
I'm afraid
Harry.
This book, it might be, you know, written to puff Harry and Meghan, but actually it might do them a real disservice in terms of their reputation, I think.
It's fascinating, really. Sarah, I want to read you something that Harry is said to have told a friend when discussing his relationship with his family. He says, I'm ready to move on past it. Whether we get an apology or accountability, who knows? Who really cares at this point? I think Harry cares. What do you make of it?
Well, I think that's just, I still don't understand what they want the apology for. What have they done?
Just everything.
Just what? Just for existing?
Does it go back to the Oprah claims about not getting help for Meghan's mental health?
Yeah. But I mean, again, apologies are sort of, I mean, what does it mean? Would it change anything materially? Would it actually make their lives any better? I think he's just being petulant as ever. I mean, that is almost the most, I mean, that's a very petulant little paragraph, isn't it? It's just, again, it's all about him. He doesn't think about anybody else. He doesn't think about what this has done to his father, what this has done to his brother, what this is doing to his two children, who will grow up completely estranged from their British family, which, you know, maybe that's the right thing, I don't know, but, you know, they might like to have some connection. I mean, imagine if you get to the age of 12 and then you suddenly realise that you're the grandson of the King of England and you've never been allowed to meet him because your father's had some absurd sort of persecution complex for most of your life.
And recording strange birthday videos for a man they barely know.
That's going to be a great series of The Crown.
Exactly. Yeah. That's what Harry just can't see, because all Harry can see is Harry's navel.
Let's make that a hashtag. Anyway, let's move on. As promised, we've got some more beautiful pictures of Catherine, Princess of Wales, and Her Majesty Queen Camilla. Enjoy this week's montage.
Thank you.
As always, if you enjoy our content, remember to like and subscribe. It's free, and that way you never need to miss another episode. And you can check out The Crown, Fact or Fiction, by clicking the link above or in the description below. And a reminder that we'll have more on that Poppy Field interview on the channel on Monday. Thank you, as ever, to my guests, Sarah, Charlotte, and Richard, and of course to you for watching. We'll see you next time. Bye-bye.